Biological information, criticizing ENCODE. We've been going through the book Biological Information, New Perspectives, edited by a number of people, and of course with chapters written by a number of other people, published by World Scientific Publishing in 2013, actually from a 2011 symposium held at Cornell University. Not directly under their auspices, and available on the net for free. I actually bought the book because I wanted to support World Scientific Publishing. The book looks like that. It is divided into four sections, plus the introduction: information theory and biology, biological information and genetic theory, theoretical molecular biology, and biological information and self-organizational complexity theory. So it is not really a totally an intelligent design book, this last chapter. In fact, approaches things from self-organization and not from intelligent design. but it is critical of evolutionary theory. We are looking at the first chapter in biological information and genetic theory right now. And it is entitled Not Junk After All, Non-Protein Coding DNA Carries Extensive Biological Information, written by Jonathan Wells. And it's a classical article, the classical article about junk DNA. Jonathan Wells, of course, argues that there is none, really. Ono written in 1972, So Much Junk DNA in Our Genome. And it's available on the internet. And it argues that there's more than 90% degeneracy contained within our genome. And that is actually a quote from the passage, more than 90% degeneracy contained within our genome should be kept in mind when we consider evolutional changes in genome sizes. So the human genome is more than 90% junk. Richard Dawkins, in The Greatest Show on Earth, would say, leaving pseudogenes aside, it is a remarkable fact that the greater part, I assume that means we're not talking about pseudogenes rather than we're not counting them in this number. 95% in the case of humans of the genome might as well not be there for all the difference it makes. So this is going from 90% or above to 95%. And if you look at his work that's published in the Skeptics magazine, it says, can we measure the information capacity of that portion of the genome which is actually used? We can at least estimate it. In the case of the human genome, it is about 2%. So now we've gone from 90% plus to 95% to 98%. Well, 98% is probably stretching it a bit. Actually, if you go back to Wikipedia, you can't do this now, by the way, it's all gone. This is screen captured from way back when. About 97% of the human genome has been designated as junk, including most sequences within introns and most intergenic DNA. So they're saying 97%. And it's beginning to sound like the chimpanzee-human identity. So you're looking at really pretty much all of the, except for 2%, 3%, 5%. I've even ran into one person that said 99%, but that most people will say, no, really it has to be 98% or less that's junk. But we're talking about that range. Now, I will say that when people are doing it without regard to the controversy, it tends to be more like 90%. When people start arguing about the controversy, it tends to be closer to 97%. I think that that's because 97% is more impressive than 90%. Which is an interesting point in and of itself. Oh, no, actually, was not the first. He's the first quoted one. But in a website hosted by Dan Graur, whom we will meet later, a very interesting guy, he notes that it was used back in the 60s by people like Francis Crick, among others, the co-discoverer of DNA. And the comments are even more interesting. One of the comments says, in the yearbook of the Carnegie Institution, Washington, July 1, 1959 to June 30, 1960. So this is kind of one of these quasi, not really peer-reviewed, but kind of, you know, summarized things. The yearbook, volume 59, page 278. And you can find it there. Now, I actually put the full website. If you go there, it doesn't show the full website. But if you click on it, it'll get you to this. And he says, and I checked, it's there. It is much more difficult, by the way, that's these yellow things are mine, these white ones are theirs. It is much more difficult to imagine how different DNAs could act as templates for the similar RNAs. This is the problem that can be avoided most easily by considering a large part of the DNA to be junk. So we can trace junk DNA in printed form, well, maybe not precise term, but the concept certainly, all the way back to 1960 at least. And then the next comment is even more fascinating. Regarding Roberts' paper, this is very interesting find. Note that Rich Roberts is the guy who named the ribosome. To understand this report, you need to understand that this was 1959 to 1960. 2 years before the discovery of mRNA. They didn't know about mRNA. They knew about ribosomal RNA. Back then, it was believed that each gene made a separate RNA that got incorporated into a ribosome, that is, ribosomal RNA. Thus, according to this model, each ribosome contained information within it to make a single protein, a different ribosome for each protein, presumably. Of course, today we understand that ribosomes are only enzymes and that protein information is contained in mRNA. But considering that over 90% of cellular RNA is rRNA, ribosomal RNA, the old faulty model is understandable. These people were trying to figure out what's in it and they're finding this whole bunch of RNA, and most of it is ribosomal RNA. The Roberts group was analyzing the length of E. coli RNA. In the discussion, they write about the size of proteins and note that some of these are very small. In contrast, there was too much RNA in each ribosome. So there's too much RNA to code for the protein. This discrepancy indicated that in these cases, the additional RNA was likely non-functional. Interestingly, they called this non-functional nucleic acid repugnant. Interestingly, Roberts missed a more critical fact that was pointed out by others, and he's suggesting a couple of names, that rRNA did not have enough nucleotides to code for certain large proteins, beta-galactosidase, for example. So not only is the ribosomal RNA too big to code for some proteins, it's too small to code for others. Roberts' group also noted that all ribosomal RNAs looked the same, whereas the nucleotide composition of DNA varied considerably. Thus, some DNA must not code for ribosomal RNA, and this is where they invoke the idea of junk DNA. Notice that a new form of RNA, messenger RNA, was recognized in a landmark paper by Brenner, Jacob, and Meselson, in 1961, making this whole discussion moot. And yes, I'm aware that Watson's group also demonstrated the existence of mRNA. In any case, it is interesting to how the word junk was floating around. Now, think about this. Back then, they did the best they could with the information they had, and then somebody said, well, maybe the rest of it's just junk. Think about what we're doing now. Raises some interesting questions. Okay, the ENCODE Project Consortium. Now we're moving to where they claim is very little mRNA. Very little junk, I'm sorry. The ENCODE Project Consortium in 2012, an integrated encyclopedia of DNA elements in the human genome. And the reference is there, and you actually can get this on the internet for free. Now you're going, that's a weird name for an author. It is the lead paper for 32 other papers in 5 different journals that all came out at about the same time, and some more that have come out since as well. So they're continuing to publish. But here's why they called it the ENCODE Consortium, because if you look at the ENCODE Project Consortium, this is the list of authors. No, actually, this is not the list of authors. This is a first part of the list of authors, and there's the second part, and there's the third part, and there's the fourth part, and there's the fifth part. 2 pages of authors. Okay. I am now quoting little pieces of ENCODE, except where I put it in yellow, which is my summary. The vast majority, 80.4% of the human genome, participates in at least one biochemical RNA and or chromatin-associated event in at least one cell type. So they're saying we can detect biochemical function of 80% of the DNA. The Encyclopedia of DNA Elements, or ENCODE Project, aims to delineate all functional elements encoded in the human genome. Operationally, this is their definition, we define a functional element as a discrete genome segment that encodes a defined product, for example, a protein or non-coding RNA, or displays a reproducible biochemical signature, for example, protein binding, or specific chromatin structure. So they're defining it in terms of some kind of biochemical difference that it makes. Excuse me. Transcribed and protein coding regions. Protein bound regions. DNA's 1 hypersensitive sites and footprints, and you're going, what function is that? Well, I'll tell you. Chromatin accessibility is characterized by DNase 1 hypersensitivity is the hallmark of regulatory DNA regions. So when they say they've got DNase 1 hypersensitivity sites and footprints, they're suggesting that these might be regulatory elements.
Why not just say binding rather hypersensitive?
Go ahead and take the mic and we'll let you keep it for a little while. Because they haven't identified whether this is regulatory or not. It's too much work yet. So they are looking for indicators of regulatory activity, and this is one. Now, that raises a question, have they proved their case? No, I don't think so. They have suggested a case, though, and I think that that's a reasonable suggestion, at least to start with. Regions of histone modification, DNA methylation, and they'll explain in the chapter why they picked that one. From comparative genomic studies, at least 3 to 8% of bases are under purifying or negative selection, indicating that these bases may potentially be functional. We previously found that 60% of mammalian evolutionary constraint bases were annotated in the ENCODE pilot project, but also observed that many functional elements lacked evidence of constraint, a conclusion substantiated by others. So that what they're saying is that some functional elements don't have constraint, so the fact that they're not constrained is not an adequate reason to say they can't be functional. 80.4%, remember, have biological function. That's my wording, of course. Different RNA types account for 62% of the genome. I forgot to put those are actually my ellipses as well. Different RNA types, 62% of the genome. So 62% is transcribed. 56.1% are regions that are highly enriched for histone modifications. Regions of open chromatin are 15.2%. Sites of transcription binding factor are 8.1%. And there's some other ones that I won't go into. Now, for what it's worth, you'll notice that those add up to considerably more than 80.4%. But some places will have more than one indicator of function. So now, as we've noted, this is not totally watertight case. But there are some people who felt that not only is it a not watertight case, but they're just plain wrong. And now we come to the Dan Grauer that had that one site on DNA. This is available on the net too. Dan Grauer is a professor of, I think it's biochemistry and biology or something like that, at the University of Houston. And he has a number of his, I'm gathering his either students or colleagues that have co-authored this paper with him, on the immortality of television sets. Function in the human genome according to the evolution-free gospel of ENCODE. Problem with ENCODE is that it's evolution-free. The abstract. A recent slew of ENCODE consortium publications, specifically the article signed by all consortium members, put forward the idea that more than 80% of the human genome is functional. This claim flies in the face of current estimates according to which the fraction of the genome that is evolutionarily conserved through purifying selection is under 10%. And if it's not conserved, it can't be functional. Thus, according to ENCODE Consortium, a biological function can be maintained indefinitely without selection, which implies that at least 80-1 or 70% of the genome is perfectly invulnerable to deleterious mutations, either because no mutation can ever occur in these functional regions or because no mutation in these regions can ever be deleterious.
At least he quickly realizes the implications.
Yes. Yes, it does. Which is partly why we're bringing it to the Sab School today. This absurd conclusion was reached through various means, chiefly by 1. Employing the seldom used causal role definition of biological function, and then applying it inconsistently to different biochemical properties. 2. By committing a logical fallacy known as affirming the consequent. 3. By failing to appreciate the crucial difference between junk DNA and garbage DNA. 4. By using analytical methods that yield biased errors and inflate estimates of functionality. 5. Favoring statistical sensitivity over specificity. And 6. By emphasizing statistical significance rather than magnitude of the effect. Those are the charges. Here we detail the many logical and methodological transgressions involved in assigning the functionality to almost every nucleotide in the human genome. The ENCODE results were predicted by one of its authors to necessitate the rewriting of textbooks. We agree, many textbooks dealing with marketing, mass media hype, and public relations may well have to be rewritten. How's that for snark? He starts with 3 quotes, and this will give you kind of a setting of where he's coming from, if you haven't gotten it already. Data is not information. Information is not knowledge. Knowledge is not wisdom. Wisdom is not truth. I would be quite proud to have served on the committee that designed the E. coli genome. There is, however, no way that I would admit to serving on a committee that designed the human genome. Not even a university committee could botch something that badly. Now, you notice that he's citing people, but you will also notice that he is citing them, which presumes that he agrees with the sentiment. The onion test is a simple reality check for anyone who thinks they can assign a function to every nucleotide in the human genome. Whatever your proposed functions are, ask yourself this question. Why does an onion need a genome that is about 5 times larger than ours? By the way, a salamander needs the needs a genome that is about 100 times ours. And yet the bladderwort, I think it is, has a genome that is about 5% of ours or something like that. And here we go with ENCODE. This is, we're starting with the very first sentence, except for those quotes, of course. And we will not, of course, read it all the way through because it takes too long. Hopefully those of you who are really interested will either have read it or will read it online.
So this ENCODE consortium, you can't claim that they're all creationists, right?
I mean, no.
What would be their motive then for... You'd have to postulate a motive for them to, or a bias or something.
That's a very interesting question. Early releases of the Encyclopedia of DNA Elements, or ENCODE, were mainly aimed at providing a parts list for the human genome, the ENCODE Project Consortium in 2004. The latest batch of ENCODE Consortium publications, specifically the article signed by all consortium members, the ENCODE Project Consortium in 2012, has much more ambitious, that's the article we just reviewed very briefly, has much more ambitious interpretive aims and a much better orchestrated public relations campaign. The ENCODE Consortium aims to convince its readers that almost every nucleotide in the human genome has a function and that these functions can be maintained indefinitely without selection. Now remember, he's not objecting to everything has a function. He's objecting to these functions can be maintained indefinitely without selection. The ENCODE Project Consortium assigns function to 84.4% of the genome. We disagree with this estimate. However, before challenging this estimate, it is necessary to discuss the meaning of function and functionality. Like many words in the English language, these terms have numerous meanings. What meaning, then, should we use? In biology, there are two main concepts of function. The selected effect and causal effect concepts of function. The selected effect concept is historical and evolutionary. Accordingly, for a trait T to have a proper biological function F, it is necessary and almost sufficient that the following two conditions hold. T originated as a reproduction, copy of a copy of a copy, of some prior trait that performed F, or some function similar to F, in the past. And two, T exists because of F. In other words, the selected effect function of a trait is the effect for which it was selected, or by which it is maintained. In contrast, the causal role concept is ahistorical and non-evolutionary. That is, for a trait Q to have a causal role function, G, it is necessary and sufficient that Q performs G. And that's all. For clarity, let us use the following illustration. There are two almost identical sequences in the genome, or perhaps for this short a period, maybe identical. The first, TATAAA, has been maintained by natural selection to bind a transcription factor, hence its selected effect function is to bind this transcription factor. That's the famous TATA box. A second sequence has arisen by mutation, and purely by chance, it resembles the first sequence. Therefore, it also binds the transcription factor. However, transcription factor binding to the second sequence does not result in transcription. That is, it has no adaptive or maladaptive consequence. Thus, the second sequence has no selected effect function, but its causal role function is to bind transcription factor. So finding binding sites for protein might overestimate the actual functional so that's the point he's making, and I think it's a valid point. The causal role concept of function can lead to bizarre outcomes in the biological sciences. For example, while the selected effect function of the heart can be stated unambiguously to be pumping of blood, The heart may be assigned many additional causal role functions, such as adding 300 grams to body weight, producing sounds, and governing preventing the pericardium from deflating onto itself. As a result, most biologists use the selected effect concept of function, following the Dobzhansky dictum, according to which biological sense can only be derived from evolutionary context. And if you ever wonder why Theodosius Dobzhansky said that, that's why he said it. We note that the causal role concept may sometimes be useful, mostly as an ad hoc device for traits whose evolutionary history and underlying biology are obscure. This is obviously not the case with DNA sequences. The main advantage of the selected effect function definition is that it suggests a clear and conservative method of inference for functions in DNA sequences. Only sequences that can be shown to be under selection can be claimed with any degree of confidence to be functional. The selected effect definition of function has led to the discovery of many new functions, for example, microRNAs. In other words, they were found to be conserved, and so people said, well, they must do something then, and so they figured out that they did something. And to the rejection of putative functions, e.g., what's actually pronounced apparently as pneumites. And you're going, how do you get that? Well, it's new mitochondrial DNA in the regular DNA, in the nuclear DNA. I read the paper. I'm not sure that you can be totally confident that all of that can be rejected, but that's a matter of dispute, I suppose. From an evolutionary viewpoint, a function can be assigned to a DNA sequence if and only if it is possible to destroy it. All functional entities in the universe can be rendered non-functional by the ravages of time, entropy, mutation, and what have you. Unless a genomic functionality is actively protected by selection, what is sometimes known as negative selection, it will accumulate deleterious mutations and will cease to be functional. The absurd alternative, which unfortunately was adopted by ENCODE, or was it, is to assume that no deleterious mutations can ever occur in the regions they have deemed to be functional. Such an assumption is akin to claiming that a television set left out and unattended will still be in working condition after a million years because no natural events such as rust, erosion, static electricity, and earthquakes can affect it. Of course, it is not always easy to detect selection. Functional sequences may be under selective regimes that are difficult to detect, such as positive selection, or weak, statistically undetectable purifying selection, or negative selection as it's sometimes called, or they may be recently evolved species-specific elements. So if you have species-specific elements, they won't look like they're under selection from the mouse to the human because they're brand new human selection. Or brand new human elements. And so you can't detect selection. In fact, if they're brand new from chimpanzee, you can't even detect it from chimpanzee. That's, of course, assuming that evolution is true. So while...
Now he's accounting for proofreading and repair processes.
Yeah. But the important thing is, why would you proofread it and repair it if it really doesn't matter?
Right.
And we're going to get into, he has a point, but I want to point out that he also concedes that there is a point for the other guys, that maybe these things are brand new for humans. But you see, 80% of the genome being brand new for humans, that or 60% or whatever, 70%, that's not... that's not a comforting thought, because we're supposed to be 95 or 99 or whatever it is percent chimpanzee. So how did all that stuff get preserved? We recognize these difficulties, but it would be ridiculous to assume that 70%+ of the human genome consists of elements under undetectable selection. That's the bottom line of what he's saying, especially given other pieces of evidence such as mutational load. So if you ever wonder about whether Sanford is right about genetic entropy, he's right, they know it. Here, the proportion of the human genome that is functional is likely to be larger to some extent than the approximately 9% for which there exists some evidence for selection. But the fraction is unlikely to be anything even approaching 80%. So basically he's saying, yeah, it could happen, but it's way too much. Finally, we would like to emphasize that the fact that it is sometimes difficult to identify selection should never be used as a justification to ignore selection altogether in assigning functionality to parts of the human genome. Who says you have to ignore it altogether? Estimates of functionality based on conservation are likely to be, well, conservative. Thus, the aim of the ENCODE consortium to identify functions experimentally is, in principle, a worthy one. Problem is, it runs afoul of evolution. We have already seen that the ENCODE uses an evolution-free definition of functionality. Let us, for the sake of argument, assume that there is nothing wrong with this practice. Do they use the concept of causal role function properly? And, of course, the answer that he will give is no. I'm going to be kind of skimming through the rest of this because of time limitations, but I'll try to give you some of the highlights. According to Ankar, and for a DNA segment to be ascribed to functionality, it needs to be 1, transcribed, or 2, associated with a modified histone, or 3, located in an open chromatin area, or 4, bind to transcription factors, or 5, to contain a methylated CpG dinucleotide. We notice that most of these properties of DNA do not describe a function. Some describe a particular genomic location or a feature related to nucleoside composition. Also features related to function, but we're not going to point that out yet because that would make Ankar look too logical. To turn these properties into causal role functions, the ENCODE authors engage in a logical fallacy known as affirming the consequent. The ENCODE argument goes like this. DNA segments that function in a particular biological process, for example, regulating transcription, tend to display a certain property. Transcription factors bind to them. A DNA segment displays the same property. Transcription factors bind to them. Therefore, the DNA segment is functional. Now, of course, that's bad logic, but it would be reasonable to say, then perhaps we should look for function in these particular segments of DNA. So far, we have seen that as far as functionality is concerned, ENCODE uses the wrong definition wrongly. We must now address the question of consistency. Specifically, did ENCODE use the wrong definition wrongly in a consistent manner? We don't think so. For example, the ENCODE authors singled out transcription as a function, as if the passage of RNA polymerase through DNA sequence is in some way more meaningful than other functions. Why make a big fuss of about 74.7% of the genome that is transcribed, and yet ignore the fact that 100% of the genome takes part in a strikingly reproducible biochemical signature? It replicates. So 100% of the genome must be necessary. Actually, the ENCODE authors could have chosen any of a number of arbitrary percentages functional, and they did. In their scientific publications, ENCODE promoted the idea that 80% of the human genome was functional. The scientific commentators followed and proclaimed that at least 80% of the genome is active and needed. Subsequently, one of the lead authors of ENCODE admitted that the press conference misled people. That should be LED, I believe, by claiming that 80% of our genome was essential and useful. He put that number at 40%. I will say I had trouble tracking that particular reference down. While another lead author reduced the fraction of the genome that is devoted to function to merely 20%. I had trouble tracking that down, but I did find one by Stavronopoulos, actually he's longer than that, I think, a Greek guy who said the same thing. So I wouldn't be surprised if Hall said that. Interestingly, even when a lead author of ENCODE reduced the functional genomic fraction to 20%, he continued to insist that the term junk DNA needs to be totally expunged from the lexicon, inventing a new arithmetic according to which 20% is greater than 80%. In its synopsis of the year 2012, the journal Nature of ENCODE, the journal adopted the more modest estimate and summarized the findings of ENCODE by stating that at least 20% of the genome can influence gene expression. Science stuck to its maximalist guns, and its summary of 2012 repeated the claim that the functional portion of the human genome equals 80%. Unfortunately, neither 80% nor 20% are based on actual evidence. What? No, it's evidence that you like. It may be wrong, but it's based on evidence. The vast majority of comparative genomic studies suggested that less than 15% of the genome is functional according to the evolutionary conservation criterion. And here I'm skipping a lot of stuff. 5%, about 5%, is intraspecifically conserved with, if you add intraspecific variation, that is within humans, for example, an additional 4%. Oh! 4% is conserved with humans, but not conserved between humans and chimpanzees or humans and mice. Interesting. The journal Science used this value to proclaim no more junk DNA, early 2012, thus in effect rounding up 9%. Notice that ONO is just less than 10%, to 100%. According to ENCODE, 74.7% of the genome is transcribed, 56.1% is associated with modified histones, 15.2% is found in open chromatin areas, 8.5% binds transcription factors, and 4.6% consists of methylated CpG dinucleotides. Below, we discuss the validity of each of these functions, and they go on to do so. The human genome is populated by a very large number of transposable and mobile elements. Transposable elements such as lines, signs, retroviruses, and DNA transposons may in fact account for up to 2/3 of the human genome and for more than 30% of the transcriptome. Those of you who were around when Bob Miloshenko presented lines and signs may be very interested at this point. If there was a single succinct take-home message of the ENCODE consortium, it was a battle cry, junk DNA is dead. Actually, a surprisingly large number of scientists have had their knickers in a twist over junk DNA ever since the term was coined by Susumu Ono, which it actually wasn't, as Dan Grauer later found out. The paucity of protein-coding genes in the lowly, in the human genome, in conjunction with the fact that the lowly nematode, Cataribensis elegans, turned out to have 20,517 protein-coding genes, which is virtually identical with ours in terms of number, resulted in a puzzling situation similar to the C-value paradox, whereby the number of genes did not sit well with the perceived complexity of the human organism. Thus, junk DNA had to go. That sounds like a rational way of looking at things. It has been pointed to us that junk DNA, garbage DNA, and functional DNA, and I probably should just pull in the distinction briefly, junk DNA is DNA that may someday come in useful, sort of like the junk in your attic. Garbage DNA is stuff that's totally worthless and is worth just taking out to the rubbish heap. Okay. Their evolutionary definitions. And functional DNA, of course, is DNA that actually does something worthwhile. May not add up to 100% because some parts of the genome may be functional but not under constraint with respect to nucleoside composition. What an admission. We tentatively call such genomic segments indifferent DNA. Indifferent DNA refers to DNA sites that are functional but show no evidence of selection against point mutations. Deletion of these sites, however, is deleterious and is subject to purifying selection. Examples of indifferent DNA are spacers and flanking elements, need to support the tatterbox from the rest of the gene. You know, maybe you need 20, but 12 is too little, but the 20 can be pretty much whatever you want, except they shouldn't be more tatterboxes. Spacers and flanking elements whose presence is required but whose sequence is not important. Another such case is the third position of the fourfold redundant codons. You may remember that CCC codes for proline, but so does CCA, CCT, CCG. It really doesn't matter what that is, but you can't take it out because then you get a frame shift mutation. We urge biologists not to be afraid of junk DNA. The only people that should be afraid are those claiming that natural processes are insufficient to explain life and that evolutionary theory should be supplemented or supplanted by an intelligent designer. For example, Dembski, 1998, Wells, 2004. This ENCODE stuff is just too ID-friendly. ENCODE's take-home message that everything has a function implies purpose, and purpose is the only thing that evolution cannot provide. Needless to say, in light of our investigation of the ENCODE publication, it is safe to say to state that the news concerning the death of junk DNA have been greatly exaggerated. Now, that's not all of the paper, obviously. You know, you're welcome to read the rest of it, but we'll never get through if we try to read the whole thing. My own take on this is that I think ENCODE has done a lot of good work, and I don't think too many people dispute that ENCODE's estimates of functional DNA are reasonable, but they're not, in fact, proven. So I think that a more respectful tone, well, we'll go on. Dan Grier's arguments are reasonable if one assumes that evolutionary changes must be gradual and that there have been such. If one does not assume gradual evolution, of course, the reasoning falls apart. I hope his reasoning does not shut down research into the subject. I hope people don't say, well, ENCODE can't possibly have found function for all this stuff, so let's not try to find out if there is some.
Is the ENCODE an ongoing project, or it's already been completed, or what?
It's supposed to be an ongoing project, although I think that if Dan Grauer were on the committee, he would be voting against it.
What's he afraid of?
What?
I mean, why not continue the research? You know, what's he afraid of?
Because you can see where this is going,
yeah,
and we don't want to go there. Because we know it can't possibly be there.
So he thinks it's a false paradigm to perform research from.
Right. Now, Grauer, I think, is much more snide than he needs to be, especially considering that he admits that ENCODE's underlying assumptions are not unreasonable in themselves.
Well, so then.
I think evolution is powering his critique and is powering the snideness of the critique. I think it is reasonable for Grauer to point out that ENCODE raises problems that it has not addressed. And I think it's reasonable for him to try to address them. I think that to try to pretend that all of those scientists don't really know anything is probably stretching it a bit. Grauer uses evolution to prove ENCODE's estimates are wildly exaggerated. This cuts both ways. Even if ENCODE is only partly right and there's 20% of the genome is truly functional instead of 80%, then we have unselected functionality for 10% of the genome, which is degenerating because of genetic entropy, and the human species can't be that old. What he's saying, what's happening is, if he turns out to be wrong, then not only is creationism true, but without some kind of divine sustention for millions of years, sustaining, that short-age creation is correct. I think one gets a better idea of what is at stake by understanding the conflict. Grauer is in effect going all in, as the poker would say. He's betting the farm, trying to save the concept of junk DNA. If he loses, the concept of evolution explaining genetics will take a severe hit. Grauer may be partly right. Transposable elements may be truly junk, or even worse. You may remember Bob Melishenko's presentations here earlier, that for the audience on the internet, we may want to know that they're available there as well. They could be the result of, or partly the cause of, sin. In that case, ENCODE was too liberal in finding functions for DNA. So ENCODE may be partly wrong, too. Some functions may turn out to be, in fact, deleterious. We may not be what we used to be or what we should have been. But that's my opinion. Now it's your turn.
Question I would raise here is, they did challenge ENCODE on the causal rule of the definition of cause and so on, and it's true, it's not as clear as you'd like, but the traditional argument against the usefulness of the genome and so on is that if it was not useful, it would degenerate.
That's right.
And they haven't, he hasn't, has he, does he ignore that? He's lost the whole argument right there. If he quantifies his rates of genetic change. By quantify, I mean time, using if he tries and put it in within his 4 billion years, whatever you want to say, 5 billion years for evolution of life, he's going to lose it.
If it's not useful, it degenerates.
It should.
So why do we have so much useless information?
Why does it remain consistent?
You know, I'm going to give a reverse C paradox, and that is, if the bladder wart can have 97% coding DNA plus introns and whatever, why is the human DNA not 90%, 97%? Apparently, some organisms can select out, get rid of junk DNA. Why can't we?
Well, if you're going to survive, you get a route, you survive and so on. But
Why can't mice, which is even more important, because we have a slow generation time. Mice multiply faster than rabbits.
Well, but exons, you know, are notoriously consistent.
Yes. Well, so are introns to a certain extent. They vary more than exons do. But, you know, the interesting thing is, and this is something that was not picked up back when some people picked it up, but it was not widely known, is that if you go back to the original paper on the pseudogene for beta hemoglobin, the famous, was it Gary, forgotten who it was that wrote that in Spectrum, and this is the reason for giving
Gilbert,
up.
Gary Gilbert.
Gilbert, yes. That in the original article they said that the pseudogenes aren't changing as much as the regular, most of the genome, the non-coding genome that doesn't seem to be constrained. So therefore they must have a function.
I mean, the basic argument is not answered.
No.
So I'm just curious, is there, so is Grauer kind of a lone wolf, or is there a flurry of people that support that concept, or what's the sort of the weight of evidence on the number of people's espousing this or not?
Well, it depends on who you listen to. Wikipedia, of course, sides with Grauer, but I think that that's because Wikipedia is quite cognizant of the battle with creationists and does not want to give them any quarter.
So is he a lone wolf, or is he?
He's not totally lone wolf because he had his old graduate school behind him.
So the ENCODE people, have they, as a group, taken on that challenge?
I have not seen a succinct answer to Grauer. What you're seeing here today is probably the most succinct answer you're going to find anywhere. Maybe I'm wrong and there is somebody that's taking apart Grauer.
When did ENCODE first publish this?
When did ENCODE first publish it? 2012. I think late 2012. He publishes in 2013. I haven't seen an answer. ENCODE seems to have just gone on without worrying about Grauer. Now, whether that's the right thing to do or not, I don't know. I think that there's an interesting point being made here. One of the things Grauer is really upset about is that ENCODE published 32 papers all at once. And what it meant was that he couldn't pick the papers apart one by one. And he thinks that this was planned, and therefore, you see, they're public relations people because they had this massive evidence that they presented all at once, and it was too late to try to say, oh, no, well, this paper's no good, and this paper's no good, and this paper's no good, and by the time you get done, they don't have any arguments. Because what it forced them to do is to look at the whole picture instead of little pieces of it that they could try to denigrate.
We need to keep in mind here that there aren't very many people in the world that understand this issue. This is a very complex thing, and like Pleochroichalos, I'd say also, there's only, two or three dozen people who really understand the implications of all that. But this year, this is extremely complex, and we're very fortunate to get this report here on this, because it takes a while for you to understand what these papers are all about. People don't have time to do that. And so some of these things just remain there unaddressed.
For example, the CPG stuff that they talked about, the dinucleotides that can be methylated, there is a whole argument over whether methylation means function or not, or whether it indicates the possibility of function or not, and what the probability of function is. And the fact of the matter is that in some cases we don't even have all that information yet. So ENCODE is saying there's probably a function here. He's saying there's probably not. He's saying there's almost certainly not, because evolution wouldn't allow it. And so for Dan Grauer, everything is going to have to be proved one step at a time, and proved in the face of severe critique. For these people, they're saying, hey, look at all these areas where probably there's function. Now let's go in and see if we can find out what the function is. And they're already, by the way, being successful, not in terms of CPG, but in terms of transcription factors, that Crohn's disease, certain leukocytes have turned out to be part of what's happening with Crohn's disease. And it was done on the basis of ENCODE information. So it's actually turning into something practical. We had a question here.
Just had a comment about the so-called tactics that seemed to upset him so badly. But every time you get in one of these debates with evolutionists, they seem to be able to find some new discovery that appears to me now that no one's really had time to critique.
Any other comments? We haven't heard much from this side of the room. Questions? Something that we can try to clarify a little bit.
So say more about constraint.
Just a minute. Let's get this so we can actually hear it on the recording.
Unpack the idea of constraint. I'm not sure I understand that.
Well, constraint means that if you have a code and it has a wrong codon in it, or perhaps it's shorter or longer, that it won't work, it won't do the stuff you're supposed to do. And so therefore, you don't find those, either because they die in utero, or because they grow up but they're shorter and dumber and don't leave as many kids.
So they're conserved because if it's, so it can't mutate because otherwise things won't work.
Yeah.
Okay. And there's, and so they're saying, so they're given a percent that is constrained of the genome?
Well, I think that eventually we'd like to be able to, but I don't think we have near enough information to say. And one of the reasons is because we don't understand all of it. Remember, there are these overlapping codes. Perhaps in a CCC combination, where CCA or CCT or CCG would work just as well, you can get that fine. But perhaps you need the CCG because there's another code that's on top of it. So we can't just go through and say, oh, well, all of the CCs, we don't need a G. And by the way, there are most of the amino acids actually have that redundant code.
I mean, we would say that probably most of the genome is constrained, right?
We don't really know. You see, for example, if there's supposed to be a loop of DNA that comes around and puts two parts of it together, and this is known to have happened in some cases, what's in that loop for at least that particular function doesn't really matter. So that will be something that is functional. It has to be this long. But it is not constrained because, you know, if you have a C here instead of a G, nobody really cares.
So it could be the length is more important than the actual composition of amino acids.
Right.
So you could substitute a bunch of different ones as long as the length maybe was.
Yeah. In fact, sometimes substituting the exact same ones gets you in trouble. For example, there are repeats in a gene that causes Huntington's chorea. I mean, obviously, it's not the gene that causes it. It's a gene that keeps us from getting it in the first place. But there are repeats. And if you have 5 or 6 repeats, you're fine. If you have 30 repeats, you're starting to get in trouble. If you have 100 repeats, you're going to get Huntington's chorea at a fairly young age.
Of course, though, sometimes the sequence causes a certain conformational shape, right? So that can be an issue too.
Right, right. So having too many can get you in trouble as well as having too few. Now, we don't understand exactly why having too many makes people start, you know, moving their arms funny and having their memory degenerate and getting hostile. We don't know. But something in there is doing it, and we can correlate it with the length of the repeats in that particular area. Question up here. Okay, we'll pass it across.
It's interesting in that debate where Ken Ham was debating the science man, his point was, well, evolution allows us to predict, and what would the other, you know, what does creationism allow you? Well, ENCODE is a great example that if you start with the assumption that it was designed well to begin with, you would look for function, and yet they're driving very hard at not allowing you to look for function for failure. You'll find it because that would imply the other. But it's the opposite of what he said. Evolution allows us to have a theory in order to go after certain things, and I agree, that gives you a theory in order to base your study on. Well, the reverse is true. If you assume it's designed, then you would assume that it's not all junk DNA. You would therefore look for a function. And how hard they fight against that is a reversal of their own philosophy in order to fit their worldview, not an intelligent, scientific, objective approach.
In this particular case, evolution is serving as a science stopper, which is the exact reverse of what's claimed.
Galileo's argument in reverse,
yeah,
against the church.
Yeah. We know the answers because we have this philosophy and we got it all worked out. Well, it's not really philosophy, it's just the way things are. Yes?
If I felt like I was in over my head in past weeks, I feel like I'm probably drowning today, so I'll have to ask a question to clarify.
Sure.
In one of the later slides, what was the name of the fellow who said that he wants to retain the idea of junk DNA because the only people who would be afraid of it would be the creationists, right? Because as you define junk DNA, it may turn out to render the creationists hypothesis superfluous. Is that the general idea?
Yes. Now, I think they're so immersed in knowing that they're right, yeah, that they don't look at it in quite that way.
Oh, okay.
But there probably is a little bit of an unstated subtext that this is going the wrong way, I think it's more like we have no business looking there because we know that that the keys cannot be away from the lamppost. Mm-hmm. They have to have been dropped here because keys are only dropped evolutionarily, and that leaves you inside the lamppost. So it's not quite like the drunk who looks into the lamppost because the light's better there. It's more like, well, we know that we dropped him here, so let's look around here. And don't even bother going over there. It's too expensive to look over elsewhere because you can't find it there.
There is an interesting element of money because this is also all about grant money.
Yes, and ENCODE got a huge amount of it.
So back to the adage, follow the money.
Yeah? Yeah?
Kind of scared to even ask a question, but took biochemistry about 40 years ago, and this kind of goes over my head. But if junk DNA is really floating around in the nucleus,
I'm sorry,
junk DNA is floating around in the nucleus. You see, but this is the place where all the synthesis is taking place, and it floats around without any other chemical reactions. We see people who have had, who you see, I'm sure, in the ER, that have genetic problems, and you, in your heart, you get teary-eyed. I mean, this is, how could this ever happen? And if all this junk DNA was floating around, would we not see even end of humanity by this time because of all the things that could go wrong?
Well, I would say there are two points to that. Number one is that some DNA looks like it's deliberately designed to be parasitic. And it depends on whose estimates you're using. They estimated 2/3. I've seen estimates of 1/2. I don't know enough to know whose estimate is closer to the truth. They may be including sequences that look vaguely like them and could have been derived from them, in which case, are they degenerative parasitic sections, or are they actually part of the useful DNA and the junk and the parasitic sections are feeding off of them, or perhaps imitating them in order to escape detection. The fact of the matter is we don't know. One of the things that's interesting about Bob Miloshenko's ideas is that he has predictions from the scriptures that this should be involved in human reproduction, and specifically in pain and childbirth, and it should be involved in making thorns and thistles. And it turns out that transposable elements do involve in both of those, which raises an interesting question. Maybe there is actually junk DNA, and about half of it is junk. Of course, that still leaves the other half, or the other third, or whatever it is. And if all of that stuff is necessary, that it implies that humans were remade. And remade fairly recently, because there hasn't been that much degeneration in the genome, which has some very interesting implications for the age of life on Earth.
Could not be millions of years. So there are about 4,700 different kinds of mammals in this world, and we're the only mammals who drink milk after we are weaned from the mother's breast, and we do pay the price for it. There's 5% of diabetics are really type 1, about 5%, and it has been proven that cow's milk has something to do with it. You see, certain amino acid sequence of casein, the protein in cow's milk, is really similar to the sequence of protein amino acids in the islets of Langerhans in the pancreas. And so the body creates an antibody against the one in the cow's milk, and then it hits the islets of Langerhans, and the pancreas is done. You see, and this, and it has been a theory, but it has been, I'm told that it's been proven that it's that way. So my question is, if this, all this junk is floating around in the powerhouse where protein synthesis is taking place, fat synthesis and carbohydrate synthesis is taking place, why don't they interfere with and mess up human beings very quickly?
Well, you know, this brings up a whole different subject, and that is the interaction between the environment and the genome. And some things that could be junk under most circumstances, they're just sitting there doing nothing, suddenly become very, very important in very certain specific circumstances. I have in my car a heavy round object that sits in the back. And most of the time it sits there and gathers dust. But about a week ago, I was very thankful that I had it, because one of my tires went flat and I was able to take that thing out and put it on and drive for, you know, however long I needed to until I could get the tire replaced instead of calling AAA or whatever. You know, and if you're out in the boonies, why, it's even worse, you know. There are things that are useful, but they are useful only under very specific, limited circumstances. Believe me, that spare tire is designed. Most of the time, it looks like junk. But occasionally, it comes in very, very handy. So I think we have to be really, really careful about calling things junk DNA unless we know exactly how the system works under all circumstances. And I'm afraid we're not anywhere close to that with the human genome.
Well, that's why you save the junk in the trunk or else in the attic and you throw away the garbage.
Yeah. And occasionally what you think is garbage actually can be used as junk.
You're right.
Because all you need is some kind of weight to hold something down. and stuff that has no other use can be, you know, used to do that. You can get rocks from the field and do that, for that matter.
Well, one could get by with 10% of its liver or 20% of the function of the kidney and still go. I mean, we use very little of our brain power.
Well, you think of it this way. Respiratory capacity.
Yeah.
Is for most of us sitting here, we're using probably somewhere between a fifth and a tenth of our capacity. Somebody who's running a mile hard is using 100% of the capacity. And so, you know, excess capacity has its value. But it's hard to select for it unless you require everybody to run. And it has to be everybody, because the people who don't have to run it will just sit there and their genes will just do fine until they have to run. And if running is something that's extremely rare, then it's going to be really hard to select for the ability to run in a 4-minute mile. Which suggests that it's pretty hard to evolve that stuff, even if you're trying to, you know, just use, even if the gene was as plastic as evolutionists would like you to believe, that it was easy to change from one to another, because there's no reason to have redundancy, to have excess capacity, except for a very small selected portion of the population. And that's just not enough selection to keep the trait going. We have a comment over here. We finally got one from the right.
Yeah, I was just wondering, in his comment about the logic being logically inconsistent about affirming the consequent. About affirming the consequent. He's assuming that the functionality they're talking about, though, if the argument is logically, the logic of the consequent assumes that that functionality would be necessary, if that is a logical problem. So is that always the case, that the functionality, you know, you're describing now some functionality that only shows up now and then, so it's not always necessary. So if they're to say that it's logically wrong requires for that specific criticism he was giving requires that it's necessary all the time in order for that to be true, I think.
Well, we have a whole problem with how you define function. 99%+ of the things that people do nowadays, except for typing on a computer, and not really even that, because you can get by without them, requires the little fingers. So are little fingers really necessary or not? Well, no. People who get their little fingers cut off don't die. They actually can function pretty well, unless they're violinists. You know, or some weird stuff like that. If you dig ditches and you're missing a finger, there are lots of ditch diggers that are missing fingers. And they do, you can't really walk up and say, oh, that one's missing a finger because he's only digging at 80% strength. You know, it's not that way. And so you have, part of the problem is that these people want their opponents to be logically watertight, but they don't have to be, because they have evolution on their side. And part of the thing is that logical arguments, in fact, logical flaws, come from the fact that they're sometimes useful. If they were never useful, everybody would know that the logic was wrong and it would not be a problem. Let me illustrate to you the ad hoc fallacy. You know, the guy's a liar, so why do you believe him? Sometimes liars tell you the truth. Sometimes people lie only on rare occasions. Sometimes you will rely on them most of the time, just it's when you have to hand money over to them that you're not going to believe them. But, you know, if somebody's a liar and they tell me that that they want my bank account number, I'm going to go, you know, maybe you want it for a good reason, but I don't trust you, right? Okay, so the ad hoc fallacy, even though it is a logical fallacy, experientially it's reasonable most of the time. Otherwise, nobody would ever make the mistake. The same thing is true of if A, then B, B, therefore A. Well, it's not always true. It, obviously, you could be C instead of A and then B. But if you do get B, you think maybe A is true also. And it's worth looking at. And depending on the circumstances, you might be 99% right, or you might be 0.1% right. So to say that they argue this way, I didn't ever find anywhere in the paper where they said these had to be functional. But you see, to Dan Grauer and company, and it is company. By the way, the internet, what I call the Darwin bots, the people who are, you know, in there defending Darwin at every, and there's the same group, by the way, most of the time. You read there, I mean, you know, you'll find names that recur again and again and again. Those people, for those people, Dan Grauer has answered the question. And so what's happened is Dan Grauer says it can't be that it's got to be more like 9% of the human genome is actually functional, which means 91% junk. That's Dan Grauer's position, which is basically the position of Ono way back when. And so he's saying that only 9% can be actually functional. And when you start presenting evidence that says, well, maybe it's more like 11, maybe it's more like 20, maybe it's more like 80, he's going to say, what do you mean maybe? You haven't proved a thing. You, in fact, not only have you not proved a thing, you have no evidence. There's an underlying and emotional tone to this whole thing. It's not just an objective look at, well, maybe it could be this way, maybe it could be that way. You know, this way is more friendly to what I believe in general, so this is kind of the way I'd like to see it. But, you know, let's explore and find out. It's not that attitude at all. It's more like, you know, evolution is right. You know it's right, and if evolution is right, then these consequences follow. And so don't come to me telling me about 20%, let alone 80%. It's got to be less than 10. It's just got to be, because otherwise you can't explain it on an evolutionary basis. That cuts both ways. Yeah, and then I think we'll probably call it quits for the formal stuff. Let's bring the microphone here and then your comment.
Well, silly me here, I always thought that the hypothesis was supposed to be fit the facts rather than the facts. This is really basic stuff, you know, I mean, we're...
Welcome to the world of science.
I was just a little humor on this. Years ago, I was a kid. My dad was trying to make it to the last ferry in the evening. This was Cape Hatteras, 2 hours on a promontory. My dad was trying to make it to the ferry at Cape Hatteras, and it's 2 islands and a promontory. So there's several ferries there. And he had not just one flat tire, he had three, trying to get there on time. So obviously we didn't make it. So I guess maybe that's when you get cancer, I don't know.
Yeah. Well, sometimes no matter what you do, you're going to wind up, if he had three tires in another setting, he'll have four flat tires. So
two cars, you can't
provide for everything. That's true. But to say that because the spare tire has never been used yet is not to say that
ridiculous.
It's useless. Yeah. And we have to be really, really careful about function. I think on both sides. I think we have to be careful. We think we know how it works. Maybe the way it works right now isn't the way it was intended to originally. And maybe there's been some damage, and maybe we aren't as good as we think we are. If you read the literature now, we're finding out that we're not as smart as Aristotle was. And that's probably true.
Yeah, that's always been something I think.
Anyway,
come
back next week. We'll continue in the book. Sooner or later, I have another interesting subject to bring to you on detecting design. But that's for another day.